What would a Pokemon food web look like in the Asado Desert in Pokemon Scarlet and Pokemon Violet? These new routes are jam-packed with Pokemon, so this food web is gonna be nuts, so let's get into it. Starting off like most other food webs, we have the sun supplying energy to our producers. In deserts, most of these are going to be shrubs, cactuses, and grasses. Plants that are more drought-tolerant and can survive the harsh conditions that a desert brings. We also have a few Pokemon producers in Cacnea and Cacturne, and possibly even Stonejourner. Stonejourner's Pokedex states that it spends its entire life watching the sun and commonly lives in grasslands, habitats that get plenty of sunlight. It might not look like your traditional producer, but this entry sure makes it sound like one. Because what do plants do besides watch the sun every day?
Solar beam, Bulbasaur's strongest attack.
Maybe it forms a symbiotic relationship with photosynthetic lichens that help it obtain energy. Lichens themselves are already a symbiotic relationship, being a composite organism of algae and fungus. Many different species of lichens grow on rocks, and what is Stonejourner but basically a giant living rock? If you guys have other ideas about Stonejourner, let me know in the comments. Next, organisms feeding on producers are called primary consumers, or more commonly called herbivores. For a non-Pokemon entry, I'm going to include invertebrates, like in many of my other Pokemon food webs, as invertebrates are incredibly important to ecosystems, and there is some evidence that they still exist in the Pokemon world. Invertebrates you can find in deserts include, but are not limited to, things like ants, bees, and beetles that feed on and help pollinate the various plants. And there are also some invertebrates that are going to feed on other invertebrates, like spiders and scorpions. Pokemon primary consumers include Larvesta, Volcarona, Combee, and Lokix, feeding on leaves and nectar. Palmo, Skiddo, Go-Goat, Numel, and Camerupt munch on low-lying plants, such as grasses and shrubs, whereas Hippopotas, Hippowdon, Phanpy, and Donphan likely have a similar diet but are able to access more subterranean food sources, such as roots and tubers. Sharkadet's Pokedex entry makes it out to be a frugivore selecting berries high in fat, which I think might be somewhat similar to Phalanx. And finally, Flittle and Espatra are going to feed mostly on a variety of plant materials, but will also snatch up invertebrates opportunistically, making them our first omnivores and our first secondary consumers. Other secondary consumers, or predators, include Diglett, Dugtrio, Dunsparce, and Larvitar, feeding mostly on subterranean invertebrates, much like modern-day moles. Sandygast, in a desert habitat, is going to represent a kind of hybrid filter feeder and ambush predator. Think of its mouth as a web for flying insects or as a pitfall trap for those crawling on the sand. It probably opportunistically catches other prey, but in this environment, I think that invertebrates make up the bulk of its diet. Next is Capsakid, which is also photosynthetic as evidenced by its green skin, as well as its Pokedex entry alluding to it changing sunlight into chemicals in its body. But it also has a pretty distinct beak-like mouth, large forward-facing eyes, and is fairly aggressive in nature, suggesting that it might also be predatory. We know from real-life biology that beaks can be an effective means in which to capture invertebrate prey. Capsakid may rely on photosynthesis for the bulk of its energy, but supplement its diet with invertebrates to help consume more vitamins and minerals in an otherwise nutrient-poor environment. Its predatory nature also foreshadows its evolution into Scovillain, which certainly looks menacing and predatory and seems to be a mixture of a theropod dinosaur, a Venus flytrap, and your favorite spicy pepper. Scovillain's large size probably means that it selects for larger prey, and I think it focuses mainly on Lokix and stray rufflets and flittles to get its meals. Another predatory Pokemon includes the wide-ranging and versatile Cyclizar, which has a feeding strategy like modern-day big cats. They cover large areas and prey primarily on young herbivores and other smaller Pokemon. Beyond this trophic level, we have tertiary and quaternary consumers. These are Pokemon like Young Goose, Gumshoes, Sandile, Krokorok, Silly Cobra, and Sandaconda. Some interesting additions to this trophic level are the members of the Knackly line. As Knackly, I think this Pokemon is mostly an insectivore, possibly exploring subterranean insect colonies, but as it evolves, it selects for larger prey. Knacklestack's Pokedex entry states that it dry cures its prey by spraying salt all over them and is supported by the move Salt Cure. This suggests that they target prey with enough meat on them that salt curing and ridding their bodies of excess moisture would have a detrimental effect. Prey such as our herbivorous Pokemon like Skidoo, Numel, and Phanpy. However, Garganical's Pokedex states that many Pokemon gather around Garganical and use it like a giant mobile salt lick. There's either some strange niche partitioning happening where only Knacklestag preys on our mammal-like Pokemon, or the line selects other prey to cure with salt. Maybe something like Cacturn or Dunsparce? Let me know what you all think in the comments. And at the termination of most of our food chains come our apex predators of the region, Crocodile, Tyranitar, and Bravery. You may not be able to actually find and catch Crocodile and Tyranitar in the Asado Desert in-game, but their pre-evolutions are present, so I thought they would make sense to add to this food web. I envision Tyranitar being fairly omnivorous and filling a somewhat similar ecological role to modern-day bears. Their tough exterior would allow them to safely chow down on cactus and other thorny desert plants, and their large size could be used for taking prey or bullying other Pokemon off of carcasses. In contrast to Tyranitar, Crocodile and Bravery are obligate carnivores, meaning that they only eat meat. Crocodile is primarily an ambush predator and can lie in wait in the sands waiting for prey to venture too close, while Bravery uses flight to cover large distances to actively search for prey. Finally, if you've seen my other Pokemon food web videos, you know that we can't forget about our Pokemon Detritivores. Members in this trophic level are commonly called scavengers and are important for nutrient recycling and consuming carcasses. Ghost types are common detritivores as they can sap the remaining life energy out of organisms, helping to break down their bodies, and can explain why they are commonly found in areas such as graveyards. Orthworm feeds on decaying plant material such as fallen leaves or dead roots, and members of the Tinkaton line specialize in cleaning up the carcasses of steel-type Pokemon, but may also be able to derive nutrients from anthropogenic metal sources since they tend to be near ancient ruins. Finally, Relore addresses the questions that arise when we see a bunch of Pokemon stuffing their faces with food. Like, shouldn't we constantly be cleaning off our shoes after chasing a herd of Tauros around? Relore is a Pokemon analog of the real-life dung beetle. Relore is likely attracted to the dung of the many large mammalian-like Pokemon found in the Asado Desert, like Camerupt or Gogunk, which it then rolls into a ball to try and attract mates. Female dung beetles, and likely female Relores, lay their eggs in the ball of dung, which are essentially a giant ball of food, as well as a nursery for their young when they hatch. There are a few more Pokemon that occasionally show up in the Asado Desert, such as Chansey, but they are unlikely to influence the food web in any meaningful way since they usually appear in low numbers and are just passing through. Let me know what you think of this Pokemon food web, and check out my channel if you want to see other videos like this one. You can also leave routes or zones in the comments that you want to see Pokemon food webs of next. And as always, thanks for watching.